fashion business, but a fashion designer would typically come in, design a couple of lines, and then they would design more lines, and then they would take on a whole category, etc. What we did was we created some roles which actually look at future trend spotting. Some people actually have gone into that, and they travel the world, they understand where the globe is as far as fashion is concerned, and come back and help us think at least 3 to 4 years ahead of time as far as fashion is concerned. Similarly, we have roles which allow them to do 6 to 9 months of stints across different functions. And after about 2 years of experiencing that, they get into their actual final role, because having had multiple experiences, they kind of know what they've got to actually do and want to do. The second big thing which every one of us must think of and do is tremendous cross-functional movements, irrespective of experience and qualification. And this actually goes against our DNA. You know, we look at, oh, how many years of experience does this person have in marketing, and how many years of deep expertise, and what kind of companies, and what kind of education background they come from. And it's actually not worked for us. So what we do is we seamlessly move people around across marketing, retail operations, maybe not design, because design really comes with an aesthetic sense, but we have something called product and all other. In fact, recently we moved a person who's seeped into warehouse and logistics into marketing. He has absolutely no idea of that function, but we've kind of trained him and developed him to help him get into that function. And that's what the millennials are looking for, different kinds of experiences and a company which will support them through that. One thing you also have to be very careful about is the kind of managers you choose for them. You cannot just put them on or tag them to anyone in the organization. Like I said, they have low tolerance to hierarchy. You don't earn their respect out of positions or titles. You earn their respect out of actual value the manager provides to them. And hence, we are also very choosy about the kind of managers the millennials work for. So we've handpicked managers who are leaders, who are coaches, who are vested in the development of these millennials in order for them to grow these millennials. And millennials need a lot of empowerment, a lot of direction, and then leave them alone and give them the freedom to do their work. In GE, I used to work for GE before I joined Madura, and we had this really very, very interesting concept. We used to do something called reverse mentoring. And reverse mentoring was millennials mentoring the older generation. We actually, Dr. Balaji spoke about official mentoring program and formal mentoring program. We had a formal reverse mentoring program. And they would reverse mentor the more technologically challenged folks of the other generation and actually feel a lot more empowered and happy about the contribution they make to this organization. And we formally attached millennials to senior leaders in the organization.
Great. I think one important, sorry to interrupt, one important thing I want you to touch upon is what efforts have been made to communicate this career progression with them, and how is the organization tracking those progression discussions or development? If you can touch upon that, and it will be good, and they're also opportunity open for you, Nagarajan. It's an important one.
So we have what is known as a career dossier discussion. So apart from your traditional performance management and all of that, every employee in our organization, and especially the millennials, have a dossier which tells them in the next 2, 3, 4, and 5 years, what are their possible roles and careers in the organization, and what are the gaps they need to develop in order to get there. This is widely publicized, so much so that the managers are now quite, anti-HR about how deep, how often and how deep the conversations get. But that is our Bible. So we take that and we actually help bridge those gaps through the years in order for them to get from A to B to C to D and to their destination role, which is how the warehouse guy moved to marketing. The one important thing about learning, though, is classroom training is passe. If you're still just focused on classroom training, you know, unlearn that. Because millennials have, like we constantly said, lower attention spans. They love bite-sized learning, and they love learning at their own pace. So what we do is provide them a bouquet of learning programs, and they are free to choose out of that. They are they're digital programs. They're also experiences. They're also shadow programs, shadow the CEO and shadow, you know, senior leaders in the organization. And we have this bouquet of offerings, and they can pick from there, you know, based on the gaps they have and the destination role they want to achieve.
Thank you very much. And we are running short of time, and I think we need to really move faster. The question is open for you from the audience side on and two important topic within the mega topic, which is career progression and development. Just raise your hands and the mic will come to you. The organizers, can you please give the mic? And I think you were supposed to ask the question.
You all heard about you whole thing. In fact, these two things major what I could guess from this. One is talent acquisition for the to retain the millennials. A lot of activities need to be done, and another is retention. In fact, my experience goes about 30 years back. The requirement were different actually for the people to retain, and the present generation, as Mr. Raghu said. 20 years above, that is 1977, I think their trend is different actually. Definitely people wanted to move out unless organization, because one example I want to quote for my question is.
So tell us the question. Please be straight with the question.
See, a person who is really talented, in fact, he gets a lot of offers, in fact, because of that, because the market is open to the environment, in fact, that for the talented people. So how do you retain? Suppose if he gets a 60% jump, a company based on other employees, they can only give a jump if you want to retain the person for only 20%, up to 20% you can go. How do you retain him when he's already got the offer of 60% and he wants to move unless you take care?
I give you a very blunt answer? If a person's got a 60% jump and wants to go, we should let him go.
Exactly.
Because, I mean, it's a 60% jump, right? And if we want to retain him, I don't think you should give him a salary increase.
Yeah.
If I may answer, if you give the person a thing on what their future could be, and if the person buys into it and is willing to stay back, fine. Otherwise, let them go. Because, I know it sounds very, but it's seriously, I'm very, very serious when I say this. If a person's got a 60% jump and wants to go and doesn't want to stay back, I don't think we should even give them a salary increase of whatever percentage, because that will create a bigger issue with people who are staying. Yeah, I think we should let them go.
I'll give you 10 seconds. I think this is important from the panel discussion. Every experiences are different. Some companies experience 5%. Some companies like yours could be 60%. But let me put a data in front of you. Great Place to Work does two types of audit. One is an engagement. One is a culture audit. On a culture audit, I found that salary for the millennials, what they expect is only on the sixth expectation. The first five expectations are nothing to do with the salary.
It is not only salary, it is the position also.
Yeah, so I think the value what you have asked in it, I find it interesting, is that how to retain. So this is a different topic by itself, and it's an outside the box of our discussion. We'll take time separately and then we'll discuss with you on the details.
The focus is on brand and The focus is on the brand and what is it the millennials are looking for. Research says that if the brand is good, if the working environment is good, 67% of the millennials are willing to stay back in the organization because he or she believes there's a future for him or her in the organization. The question you're asking is beyond the panel's discussion today.
Absolutely.
In terms of retention at the rate of 60% hike. We say, thank you, all the best and go. Is how we should look at it.
Absolutely.
The focus is on the millennial. What is it that will make him or her stay? And research very clearly proves that 67% of the people will stay back if they find meaning in what they're doing. And it's for organizations and HR professionals and the bosses to create an environment for a person to see a sense of purpose to continue and grow. That's the logic.
And by the way, we have only 8% attrition in millennials, and we are not the best paymasters by far. It's all the other stuff which actually makes
them
stay.
Absolutely.
So, just to add, I think, I think to provide a different perspective, you don't start, in my view, looking at retention after a person resigns. Today, with a lot of predictive analysis and big data and so on and so forth, there are enough and more early warning systems. So you try and prevent a person to look out. So it's not easy to look out. You need to make a CV, you need to send it off to 10 consultants, speak to so many people, get a break, wear a nice shirt or a garment, whatever. I mean, so it's a very difficult process, right? I mean, we make it very easy. What triggers a person to actually go through this? I think you kind of think. And then just to add to what Raj was saying, I think if a person has still got a 60%, I think we should get a treat from the person as part of the farewell and then let him or her go.
Thank you. I think one white paper is there. It would be interesting for you to say, see and look at it is, you can't retain people, they only stay with us. So do whatever they can stay with us. That's an retention tool. So we'll move to the third, running short of time. We have a 15 minutes window period for the question and answers. We'll move to the third question now. It's a very important one. And I think, I go to Raj for this question, and is there a need to promote work-life balance? That's the most important topic, this guy. Why only millennials? For everyone, right, from whatever generation you call that, work-life balance is haunting, and is more particularly to, is there a need to promote work-life balance and flexible schedule to in order to bring in millennials inside the organization? Raj, over to
you. Okay. Can you hear me? Yeah? Only
yes.
Some can hear me, yeah?
Yeah.
All of you can hear me?
Yes.
All right. Okay. I'll start answering this question on work-life balance at 8:20 in the night with an apology. Right? Anyway, to look at work-life balance, the important thing is, one misconception or one thing that a lot of people say is that work-life balance means work less. I think that's wrong. I don't think millennials are looking for less work. I think they're actually looking for more work. I think they're looking for more challenging work. But at the same time, I think the conversations that many of us have with millennials, as compared to, say, 20 years ago, a person will upfront ask you, I'm a sailor, will I get time to pursue my interest? Or I'm a mountaineer, can I be supported for that?
True.
I think what people are looking for is more work, more challenging work, at the same time, for flexibility. Working at, I'm telling you, my experience with working with millennials in my team, as well as in the organization, is that if there's a certain sense of purpose, and there's an alignment on that, the youngsters work as hard, if not harder, than people perhaps who are much older, or people who used to 20 years ago, right? I think the critical thing is organizations need to have, and we certainly do, offer opportunities for people to pursue interests, pursue their passion at work and outside of work. I find a lot of the youngsters want to pursue social opportunities. They want to make a difference to society. Organizations like ours, for example, have a very strong CSR function. There's a very, very strong stated volunteering policy, right, where people can actually take time off or use time off at work to go and work on social projects. There are different kinds of activities at work, apart from that, where people can pursue their interests, be it in arts, be it in sports. There are people who come in from different walks of life who come and interact, talk to people, which helps people broaden their horizons. People look for flexibility to spend time with their friends, family, etc. I think flexible work is something which is an order of the day. There are core hours defined where everybody needs to be in office as far as possible. Yeah, even that sometimes there's flexibility, there's a discussion. Yeah,
anywhere you can work.
So, yeah, and I think using technology, that flexibility is possible today. There's a lot of use of technology for that, right? So, is work-life balance important? I think certainly is. But it's got to be understood in the right perspective. You know, it's not about doing less work. It's about doing more work and having more balance, right? It's about having more flexibility. And I think a lot of organizations, especially the larger ones, even a lot of the younger, smaller ones, are doing a lot in that direction, much more than what was happening, say, even a decade ago. Yeah?
Thank you. I think one of the coaching instances I heard from a millennial is that there's a lot of difference between what is called is a lifestyle and style of life. And it clearly came out saying that it's a choice. I think Raj, you made a very, very pertinent point. If you allow people to drive their passion, which is more from inside out, I think it gives a lot of sense of accountability and responsibility towards their profession and their work. Now I also go to Raghu, please tell us, you know, from your experience and on the work-life balance.
For me, the very word or phrase work-life balance is an oxymoron. If there is work, there will be balance. If there is no work, there is no life, is how I would look at it. So therefore, this question, I think, is not to be posed to millennials, but for people who are not the millennials.
Yes, absolutely.
Is what we should pose this question on.
Absolutely.
However, for me, with the advent of technology, with people being mobile, people being aware, socially active, 24/7, work-life balance today as a context or as a concept is passé. It is work-life fusion is what we should look at. Let me give you an instance where last year, or a year before last year, it was, again, with my family, I was in Scotland at experiencing my first snowfall, which it was at the highest peak in Scotland. And on one side is a mountain with snow, with snowfall happening, my children experiencing the first snowfall. And on the other side is the valley, which is deep down where I couldn't see the end of the, where it ended, the mountain. And I get a call from India at that time for a very, very simple problem, saying that there's a performance appraisal happening, and your boss is firing me in terms of why a particular process has not been followed. What should I be doing? Was a question that person posed to me. And I said, I don't know what you should be doing. At this point of time, I feel like jumping into the valley. So the question of having clear compartments of saying this is work and this is life and this is balance doesn't exist. I think today's work environment demands that while the borders have been blurred in terms of what is free time, me time, the fact is that if you are not delivering, then it doesn't work. Very much agree with Raj when he said that, especially today's generation, and a lot more in mind, believe if the work is challenging, is exciting, is adding value. I don't think we look at the clock. It is more in terms of in the mind, in terms of I need to have that break. So the question of saying that there should be clear compartments doesn't exist. So if you're looking for it, it's only a myth. So therefore, I think as millennials, as leaders, as middle managers or whatever, it's our ability to leverage technology. It's our ability to be mobile. It's our ability to build flexibility in our approach to what work and what life is what will make a difference. EY did a survey covering 10,000 workmen across 7 countries and focused on millennials in terms of what is their primary reason for quitting. And they said it's the lack of flexibility. They did not talk of work, they did not talk of balance. They said that give us a task, give us an objective, give us a timeline for deliver, and I will deliver it. And probably that person will stretch 18, 20 hours a day. And once that is delivered, give her or him the flexibility to do what he or she wants to do.
Beautiful.
So the concept of flexi timing, the concept of focusing on objectives, the concept of focusing on deliverables, and more importantly as HR professionals, are we in line with our ability to leverage technology? I'm so much glad that Sanjukta brought the context of reverse mentoring, because most of us are actually challenged in terms of leveraging the benefits of what technology can offer. And therefore, it should be, in my view, not work-life balance, it's actually work-life fusion, and providing us the flexibility to do what we are expected and pleased to do. And therefore, are we able to then draw out what our objectives are, what our key result areas are? So it comes back to the basics. Are we able to define what we're supposed to deliver? So as HR, irrespective whether it's a millennial or oldie daddies or whoever, go back to the basics in terms of defining objectives, in defining KRAs and making things work is what will make a difference. And
thanks,
then
sir.
It becomes work-life fusion, leveraging technology, ability to actually complete what it expected to do are things which will help. And before I conclude on this particular point is in terms of the work environment itself. Is it gender neutral? I think that too plays a key role, because you cannot separate that in a work environment that this is what a boy will do, this is what a girl will do, these roles are expected for where it is. I think in building your work environment where people feel comfortable, make it a safe workplace, make it gender neutral, and then people will continue to enjoy what they're doing, being more assured in terms of what it is. So build it, it's just not just technology, it is just not KRAs, it's a combination of things that will make it work, is how I would like to respond to your question, sir.
Thank you, completely resonate. I think somewhere, and also if time permitted, it would have been also good for us to also touch upon the values and ethics connected to the organization and the direction towards the flexibility and the work-life balance. I think CSR is a great, great platform to bring those values and ethics. We are now open for a couple of questions from the audience. So, yeah. On the question three. Yeah.
If I may just add that one point. The point that you raised about values and ethics, I think it's very relevant.
Cameras, I'm sorry, it's not audible.
Yeah, that's what he was checking, whether it is audible or not. Can you replace that, please?
I take this.
Check.
Yeah. Clutch.
All right. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. The point that you raised about values and ethics, I think, is very, very critical. I think there's a premium on values match, one. There is a premium on ethical organizations, right? Premium for ethical organizations. There is a premium, a greater premium, and this is not just with millennials, but I think with people from across generations, increasingly, yeah? So don't get me wrong. I'm not saying it wasn't existing before, but I think trust plays a very, very big role, right? Ability of a manager to, or a leader to generate trust is very, very critical to a person being engaged at work and to retention, right? So I think increasingly these have become, you know, non-negotiables over a period of time. Oh, perhaps some years ago, people wouldn't think too much about these things, right? But today, there's a fair bit of consciousness on this, is what my experience is, yeah.
Thank you, Raj. We'll go with the question.
Good evening, everyone. I am Prithvi Raj. I am basically